Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's good to be with you again. My name is Pastor Kathy Schubler, and I get to serve with you today, and it's always a joy to be here with you. Well, we are called to contemplate the cost of discipleship. We might be helped by translating Paul's request to Philemon into our prayer of the day. Refresh my heart in Christ. Strengthened by the company and forgiveness of Christ in Holy Communion and recalling God's grace in remembrance of baptism, we can be strengthened in this hour to choose life in God as our own. Let us now take a few moments of silence to prepare our hearts and minds as we listen to the prelude. Let us stand for the confession and forgiveness. We open in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin in ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together in Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Amen. Let us now sing together our gathering hymn.
Oh,
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray.
Direct us, O Lord God, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading comes from Deuteronomy chapter 30. A reading from Deuteronomy. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, Then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you that you are crossing, that you today you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and the length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read Psalm 1 responsively. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the ways of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful.
Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on God's day and night.
They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore, the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall be destroyed.
The second reading is from Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I will always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. Yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 14th chapter. Now large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to wage a war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And again, our reading for this morning from our gospel lesson, this time verse 27. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Let us pray. Good and gracious Jesus, as always, I give you thanks for the day, the blessings that you bestow upon each one of us, the privilege that we have to come together in your name. Lord, remind us that everything we have is yours, and that we always are thankful for what you have given us. Continue to call us to be your disciples. All these things we pray in your most gracious and holy name. Amen. So this morning, I want you to think about some of the organizations that you've been a part of throughout the years. You know, maybe it was Scouts, maybe it was 4-H, band, a sports team, either in high school or college. Or maybe as an adult in Kiwanis or Lions or Rotary or some other business professional organization. So now think about those organizations and pick one organization, and think about all that was required of you to maintain your membership in that organization. Do you ever think about that? Yeah. Well, I'm a proud graduate of Wittenberg University, one of 22 of our ELCA colleges and university. I just had to put that part in there for you. And while there in my first year, I joined a sorority. And you know, I had been a member of other clubs and organizations in the past, but this organization required a lot. I mean, there were, of course, the membership dues, which every organization has you pay. There were the rituals. There was saying the Greek alphabet 3 times during a lit match. I know that's hazing. There were passwords and secret handshakes and learning when to wear that little pin on a certain day at a certain hour. I'm just kidding. But anyway, you know, when to wear your certain assigned jewelry. Let alone just the time and energy to be involved in the social activities, which those were fun, and community service. And I confess that I still pay my yearly dues to that organization. Well, all this, the commitment and the sacrifice we were told was for the sake of our sisterhood, that we would be there for one another. And I have been, I think. I think I have been. I meet with them yearly, my pledge class anyway. I've presided over the weddings of their children, and I've even buried a couple of my sorority sisters. Well, as I reflected on that organization in preparing for this morning, I did find it a little odd that we make more of our commitments to our various organizations and various activities than we do as disciples of Jesus. Did you ever think about that? And I suppose that many of us come here or are members for a whole variety of reasons as we profess to being followers of Jesus. You know, and I'm sure that the crowd following Jesus in our gospel lesson for today also had all kinds of reasons for following him. Some were hoping that he would heal them of some physical or mental illness. Some had seen or were hoping to see him perform some more miracles. Some were just a little bit curious about who this guy might be and finding they wanted to find maybe something meaningful in what he was saying. Some were hoping for community and acceptance. Regardless of why they were there, they were following Jesus and wanted to hear what he had to say. So think about the crowd in our lesson today. You know, some were standing really close to Jesus, not wanting to miss a word, wanting to be true disciples. Others may have been standing a little bit further away, not letting Jesus' words sink in too deeply, you know, not wanting to get caught up in all the commitment and then being asked to be on council. Well, seeing all of this, Jesus says, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." And then later in our reading, we hear that you can become his disciples only if you give up your possessions. I mean, holy moly. You know, does he know what he's asking? I mean, that's a lot of commitment and demands and sacrifice to be a disciple. I mean, what about our personal time? This is Labor Day weekend, you know. Well, after hearing that, I mean, who would want to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus, a Christian? Yes, those words cut deep. They don't just tell us to reorganize our priorities, but they tell us that there is to be only one priority. And that is in having faith in Jesus and following him. Martin Luther wrote, "A religion that gives nothing costs nothing and suffers nothing and is worth nothing." You know, many, according to Jesus, may speak the right words, but have other allegiances. I mean, when I was preparing for this sermon, I was like, can't we just find another gospel lesson, please? Please. Because I am condemned here. I am guilty. Because it is hard putting Jesus first before everything else in our lives. I mean, following Jesus takes a whole lot of commitment. And Jesus seeks disciples who are committed. Those who are aware of the cost of following him and then choose to follow him anyway. And these are the people who knew what Jesus meant when he told the crowds that day that they must hate their relatives and even their own lives, that they must give up all their possessions, that they must take up the cross and follow him into death. Following Jesus, I mean, truly following Jesus demands that we give up our own self-centeredness, that our commitment is completely in God's grace through our faith. And that's a huge challenge. I got to tell you, it's a huge challenge. I mean, to say the Greek alphabet three times on a lit match, why, that's just a piece of cake. to crave out time or carve out time in our already busy lives for an organization, or to take our kids out to the various activities, yeah, that does cause a little juggling. And keeping up with our school work while participating in sports or band that go until the late hours of the evening can be a struggle. But compared to having to take up the cross each day in order to truly follow Jesus, oof. However, and yes, there is a however, there is good news in this passage for us when and only when we are able to get over ourselves. For when we can begin to look at each relationship as a gift from God, then I think we're on the right path. When we can look around and see what we've paid for with our hard-earned money for the roof over our head or for the food that we eat and other things as not our own, but as gifts from God, then we're on the right path. When we see our parents, our children, and in fact, all our relatives and friends and neighbors as gifts from God, yeah, we're on the right path. When we realize that each breath we take, each step along the way, each thought and word and prayer we utter is from God, we're on the right path. When we're ready to share with others what God has given us as gifts, you know, to reach out to the needy, to speak up for ones who are afraid to speak, to care for the sick, to listen for those who just need someone to hear them, to search for ways to show mercy and work for justice, yes, then we are on the right path. For in giving up our lives for others, we are following Jesus to the cross. Yes, we are living his example of love and mercy and gentleness and devotion. We are counting the cost and accepting it as a way of life, the Christian way of life, today and into eternity. You know, in our society, that cross has become a symbol that we see all over the place. I mean, not just here at church. And it pops up everywhere. Sometimes it's kind of this fashion statement. And if you look at in some of the boutiques, you know, they're really kind of all glittery and just glitzed. I guess that's what they would say, right? Glitzed. You know, and I find it kind of ironic that more and more of these crosses are popping up all the time when fewer people have faith or are involved in the church. I just had to say that. You know, the calling that we have as Christians in our society to stay near the cross, Jesus says that those who want to be disciples must take up their cross and follow him. The cross is not a fashion statement, but a costly way of life that involves a selfless commitment and where a true sense of community is formed as brothers and sisters in Christ, where we support one another in our faith and help one another to see the cross, yes, where we are the body of Christ. You know, there are days, trust me, when it's hard to even see that cross as the saving grace. But that is all the more reason why we need one another, why we need to gather in this space to help one another see the cross clearly. You know, on this day, consider that cross. Consider how we are freed to live differently because of the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus through his death and resurrection and the commitment of God for each and every one of us. You know, each day we make the sign of the cross to remind us that we are marked as children of God and that we get to reclaim that identity and start all over again. So do you claim to be a disciple of Jesus? Have you really counted the cost? Have you considered the cross as you travel this pathway of discipleship? By carrying the cross, Luke, the gospel writer, invites all of us to be disciples, inviting all disciples to be willing to accompany him to his death, but into new life, a life that is eternal. Amen.
Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. We pray for the church around the world and for the mission of the gospel. Refresh the hearts of your people. Deepen our understanding of every good thing we share, and strengthen our partnerships in the faith. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For the well-being of the earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, and for streams and other bodies of water. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For the nations and those in authority, for the elected leaders of our towns, states, and country, and for international organizations. Grant wisdom to those who govern and raise up citizens who make decisions in the best interest of our neighbors. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, who struggle with homelessness or food insecurity, for those whose family life is difficult, and for all in this community who need your care, especially those on our prayer list and our staff and council. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For this community of faith, for all our labors, begun, continued, and ended in you, that they glorify your name. Bless your people with the strength to live into their many vocations for the sake of the world. Bless our choir members who commit each week to sing your praises, and to Ron, our director, his 32 years as our choir director. God of grace, we give thanks for the saints who now rest from their labors. Give us faith, like them, to love you with all our hearts, and by your mercy bring us to everlasting life. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gathered together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share the peace with one another as you are comfortable.
Peace, thank you.
Peace the Lord be with you. Peace be with you.
Yes. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Peace the Lord be with you. Peace the Lord be with you.
I invite you to take a look at the announcements in the bulletin. There are several transitional things. It's that time of the year, you know. I will point out just a couple. And one of those is the usher training, September 18th. If you are an usher, if you've been an usher, if you'd like to be an usher, if you're just curious about what ushers do, join us on the 18th, right after this worship service, for a small lunch and conversation. It's really important that if you are ushering or would like to, that you come to this meeting, because we're going to be telling you a few things you've never heard before. Vicki and I will be leading that workshop, and it's pretty important stuff. And we are always looking for ushers for this worship service, so please prayerfully consider joining us and sharing what I think is a fun thing to do. I don't get to do it very often, but once in a while I used to during the summer, and it's really fun. So take a look at that, talk to Vicki or me. The other thing I want to announce is not in the bulletin, but Dean Myers is telling us that it's time for the dart ball teams to reorganize following the pandemic. They haven't been having their meets, and now they're ready to start again. The problem is Zion needs some members. They need some players. So if you have any interest, men, women, doesn't matter, young folks, come and be a part of that. If you want more information, contact the office or Dean Myers, and they can fill you in. But think about coming. I think they meet on Monday nights generally. As much as I'd like to do it, Monday night's already pretty full. So take a look at that. Take the bulletin home, peruse it, see where you might fit in. At this time, we will continue our worship service with the offering. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, open to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Indeed, holy, almighty, and merciful God, you are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. We give you thanks for this coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In a night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his solitary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these our own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church now and forever. Amen. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Please be seated.
Please come forward, forming two lines at the direction of the ushers. We will have bread for you in the middle and wine on either side. So come, and you can drop your cups in the baskets on your way back to your seat. If you prefer gluten-free bread or with grape juice, please let us know. Thank you.
This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body.
This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. May our Lord Jesus Christ bless you and keep you, and always remember how much Jesus loves you. This is the body of Christ given for you.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And now may God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Let us now sing together our sending hymn.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.